Go there only after you answer what the instrument is, how you hold it, and etc., etc., which I'll talk about now. All right. So first and foremost, these are the headings under which I'll be discussing. One is the part of an instrument. What are the different parts of it? Then various forceps that we use in surgery, the various suturing instruments, the various type of scissors, the different type of retractors, tubes, and a few instruments under the miscellaneous category, and on which I'll not dwell too much into. Just give you the names so that you'll have an idea of what it is. So let us make this very clear. When you come to the instrument section, what is expected of you in the exam? You're sitting opposite the examiner. What is actually needed from you? First, the minute he gives you an instrument, first name the instrument. What is this instrument? Name it. And hold it like how you're going to hold it in surgery. For example, this is a scissor and we're going to hold it like this. Don't hold it like a dagger, or hold it in your left hand, hold it like this or like this. All right. So hold it like how you're going to hold it during a surgery. Proper instrument. That I'll tell you how it's to be done. Next, what is the material which is used in that particular instrument? What are the sterilization techniques that is used to sterilize that particular instrument? And what are its uses? Certain instruments have both diagnostic and therapeutic uses. Otherwise, most of the instruments invariably have only therapeutic uses. Okay. And finally, what is the specialty of this instrument? There'll be something special which is out of the normal. That's why you prefer to use it for one particular surgery. So you need to know what is the specialty in that particular instrument and any historical importance, like Cocker's forceps means who is Cocker? Is he father of thyroid surgery? But keep it in mind, the sixth and seventh point, what I mentioned here, that is the specialty and the historical importance. This should come only after you have answered the first five. Don't, as soon as they give you a Cocker's forceps, don't directly jump and say Cocker is father of thyroid surgery. No, you'll fail there directly, because the examiner who's opposite you already knows about it. Okay. He's not trying to test your knowledge. He's trying to help you. So go in a step-by-step manner, like how you read an X-ray. It's an AP view. It's a plain X-ray. Then from outside to inside, the same way. Name the instrument, hold it properly. What is the material? What is the sterilization technique? What are its uses? Then if the examiner asks you, what is so special about this? Tell. That time you can answer the sixth and seventh point. All right. So I'll just stop sharing for 1 second and I'll just spotlight my video so that I can see. Okay. So this is a artery forceps. Okay. It's a curved artery forceps. You can see that it's curved. Now you need to know what are the basic parts of an instrument. All right. This is a ring. All right. Where my finger goes into. It's a ring. So what are the fingers that we use in surgery? It is the thumb and the ring finger. All right. The thumb and the ring finger. So the ring finger goes here, the thumb goes here, and I do this. Now, next question. Why not I use my thumb and index finger? Why not thumb and middle finger? Why should I use thumb and ring finger? My dear volunteers.
Sir, to give force by the index finger and the middle finger to close the ruptures.
Okay, no. It's actually basically range of movement. All right. The index and the middle will only give you support and better control. Rather than trying to hold like this, it will just give you better control, but will not give you power. The range of movement, just have a look. If I do this, can you see how wide my mosquito forceps is opening? Now, the same thing, if I try to do with my index finger, it will not open to such an extent. Okay. So with the ring finger, see the extent. So you get a wide range of mobility and better control. Next, how far in do you put your hand inside? This should come at your distal interphalangeal joint. This is a proximal interphalangeal joint. Sorry, this is the proximal interphalangeal joint. This is the distal interphalangeal joint. So your finger rings should be at your distal interphalangeal joint. If it's too much inside, I hold something, I can't pull my hand out. It gets stuck. And when I'm doing that, if I'm holding some blood vessel, I'll end up ripping it out if I'm trying to struggle. So only distal interphalangeal joint, hold it, hand comes out. Okay. So we got the first part of the instrument, that is the rings. Okay. Through. So normally what are the fingers that go in? Thumb and ring finger. All right. This is a ratchet. Can you see this small bit here? This is what we call as a ratchet. Okay. This will help lock it in place. Once I lock it, like once I lock it really tight, it doesn't open up that easily. I have to use some different sort of movement to open. So once I've locked it, you can see that the instrument does not move or it doesn't open and close. All right. Now the same thing, this is an instrument without a ratchet. Okay, you can see there's no ratchet. Now see what happens if I don't lock it. You can see it's moving. Okay, without the ratchet, it can move around, say. So that is the point of having a ratchet. All right, it'll hold the instrument in place and it'll lock it. It'll make sure it doesn't open and close. So if I've held something like a blood vessel, you want it with the ratchet to make sure it is still holding the blood vessel and it doesn't open off on its own and the patient starts bleeding again. Next comes this part. This is what we call as the shank of the instrument. All right. And then you get the joint and the jaw. So you have the shank, the joint and the jaw. Now there are two types of joint. There is a box joint. Can you see this? Actually looks like a small square. Okay. It looks like a box. That's why it's called as a box joint. And what is more important, if you can look at it in this view, and I'm not sure if my video is very clear. You can see that one blade has come through the other blade and it's come out. Okay. So it's come like this, and these are the two limbs. So it's come through the blade of another one. That's called as a box joint. The other one is a simple screw joint. You can see closely. Okay. Is the screw visible?
Yes, anyone? Sir.
Screw is visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is a screw joint. You see, there is no box like structure, nothing on top. And they're just sitting one on top of the other like this. Okay. So it's a screw joint. A box joint is where one blade goes into the other one. A screw joint is where it just slides over each other. Okay. So you have a screw joint, this one, and you have a box joint. Okay. Box, and the importance in box joint is there is no screw on the outside. So what is the advantage of this? If I am handling any suture, I don't want the thread to get stuck around that screw, especially when I'm trying to do some delicate tying. If it gets stuck and I'm trying to pull, I don't want to cause more bleeding. So the advantage of the box joint is that there is nothing protruding outside where the suture can get stuck. Whereas in a screw joint, the suture can get stuck between the screw and the instrument. Okay. And the last one is the jaw. Okay. This is the jaw. The last bit, which is beyond the joint, is called the jaw. These jaws have various type of serrations. Now here, this is a transverse serrations, as in I can't, obviously my image is not that clear for you to see, but the serrations are from top, like transverse. If this is the instrument,
hold still. If you move, it will hold still in one place. Yeah. Appreciate better.
Yeah. So the serrations run transverse. All right. So what is the advantage of a transverse serration? If I have held some tissue like this, even if one serration slips, the next serration will hold. If I slip again, one more will hold. So it becomes traumatic. It will make sure it doesn't slip. All right. Or at least it makes sure it doesn't slip as much as possible. So whenever you have transverse serrations, it's a traumatic forceps. That means you're putting a lot of trauma. At the same time, you're trying to get as much grip as possible. Now, what are the other type of serrations? You have longitudinal serrations. So which are running along the length of my finger. So if it is longitudinal, if it slips, it will slip all along and come out. So simple, if it is transverse serrations, it's a traumatic forceps. If it's longitudinal serrations or no serrations at all, they are relatively atraumatic. Please keep this in mind. In surgery, there is nothing called as atraumatic. Whatever you are touching with an instrument or whatever, it is still traumatic, but it is less traumatic, or you can say relatively atraumatic. All right. Okay. So with that, I'll go back to this image. Okay. So like I said, the finger ring, the ratchet, the shank, the joint, the jaw, and serrations on the jaw. Okay. If you can just look at these, most of it you will only answer in the exam, if you have understood this bit of the presentation. So now let's come to the forceps. What is this forceps? Somebody. Anybody? Ashray, Tapan.
Curved forceps.
Okay, you have a straight artery and a curved artery forceps. Okay, they're also called as Kelly's forceps. But how are you going to answer it in an exam? It's a curved artery forceps. It is made up of stainless steel. Okay, all metallic instruments, stainless steel. Don't even think about it. First, blindly say stainless steel. Don't even think about anything else. Next, how is it autoclaved? Now, this is a small clue I'll give you. Any metallic instrument directly answer autoclave. Directly answer autoclave, except for sharp instruments. When I'm saying sharp, I'm saying only scissors, because autoclaving scissors can cause the scissors to become blunt. Okay. So apart from scissors, everything else autoclave. Everything else stainless steel. Okay. And look at the serrations, transverse serrations. So it's a traumatic forceps. Got it? So how are you going to name? If they give you this, you're going to say it's a straight artery forceps. It has a ratchet. It has a box joint. It has transverse serrations, and it is a traumatic forceps. It is made up of stainless steel, and it is sterilized by autoclaving this instrument. Okay. So this is exactly what I just told you. So what are its uses? Like we already discussed, somewhere deep inside the body, if I'm trying to catch hold of a blood vessel, I'm going to use this. So to grasp structures in the depth. Second, I showed you that time while dissecting, when I want to split something like this. So while dissecting, I'm going to use this forceps. So it's used for dissection and to hold sutures when I'm tying knots. So I'll need something to hold and tie. So I'm going to use this to hold sutures. Basically, if you answer one or two, more than enough. But this part is what is most important. When you say all the parts of the instrument and you tell it, the examiner will be really happy. He knows that you have understood how to hold an instrument and how it's done. Now, next, Tapan.
Yes, sir.
You're there? Okay. Why? What is the advantage of a straight forceps? What is the advantage of a curved artery forceps?
Sir, in curved artery forceps, we can see the direction at which we are intending to lock the...
Okay, so you can see the tip. So where do we use straight artery forceps then? Okay, I'll tell you, no worries. Anyway, excellent. At least you got... So the basic concept in surgery is any instrument, if it is curved like this, if I'm holding the instrument like this, like this, and my sight of vision is here, I can always see the tip. If I'm looking like this also, I can still see the tip because the tip is slightly higher than the plane of the instrument. So any curved instrument basically means you're seeing the tip, you're seeing what you're doing, you're holding something that you're seeing. Okay. Now, if that is the case, what is the advantage of a straight forceps? Let's assume there is a very narrow cavity, which is very deep, and you want to hold something. A straight forceps won't take much space. Okay, just go in and hold it. Now imagine the same thing with a curved forceps. If it is curved, you won't have that space. If it's very narrow, if you put one instrument, that only will block. You can't put another instrument to catch. That's the only difference. All right. So straight artery forceps you use in narrow spaces. Curved artery forceps, the advantage is you're seeing what you're doing. It has better visualization when compared to a straight instrument. So what is this instrument? It has a right angle to it. So simple answer, right angled forceps. It's also called as a mixture. So again, it has a ratchet, box joint, stainless steel, autoclaving. Got it? So where do we use it? So the advantage with the right angle forceps is it usually helps you get around tubular structures. That is a specialty of this instrument because it has a sharp right angle like this. So I can, if this is a tube, I can go around the tube like this and pick it up. If I have a straight forceps, if I can't do this, I'll end up tearing or damaging the vessel. So the advantage of a right angle is I can go around the tube and I can see the tip when I'm dissecting or coming out of the tissue. That is the advantage of a right angled forceps. So what is this forceps now?
Cocker's forceps.
Cocker's forceps. How is this different from an artery forceps?
Sir, it has tooth at the tip of the...
Excellent. Excellent answer. So now answer it like how we are going to answer in the exam.
Sir, this is a stainless steel instrument with rings, ratchets, shank and a box joint.
Can be there everywhere. What is the joint?
Box joint.
Excellent.
with blades having transverse serration and tooth at the tip.
So it is
probably a coccers.
Not probably, it is a coccers. It's a traumatic. Transverse serrations always blindly say traumatic. On top of that, it has a tooth. So it will definitely be more traumatic.
Yes, sir.
Okay, excellent answer, Tapan. That's all. See, if you got the concept of how to answer, you will answer most of these. Okay, very straightforward. Now, what is the advantage of a Cocker's forceps over an artery forceps? In an artery forceps, I can still slip away. Whereas in a Cocker's forceps, if I hold some along with this, if I have an extra attachment, it is even more secure. Now, this is where I was talking about that historical importance. Initially, this was used by Cocker in thyroid surgeries. Earlier, that space of Reeves and all was not done. He used to just put a Cocker's forceps along the superior pole of thyroid artery, cut it off, then tie it up. Now, we are more precise. We separate, we visualize the superior thyroid pedicle separately and we ligate it. So at that point of time, imagine if it slips with an artery forceps, the amount of bleeding which happens and the vessel retracts, it becomes a big mayhem. That is why he came up with that instrument with the tooth. All right. So basically, now what are the uses here? It is used to grasp structure and avoid slippage. That's all. It should avoid slipping. Otherwise, rest of it is the same, almost like an artery forceps. Now, what is this instrument? It has a tooth at the edge.
Sir, Ellis forceps.
Pardon me, what forceps?
Tissue holding forceps.
It is correct. Most of them are tissue holding forceps. But
Ellis tissue.
Precise, correct. It's an Ellis tissue holding forceps. This is a curved Ellis. Curved Ellis tissue holding forceps. Have you seen this instrument anywhere? In OBG, I'll even give you the clue.
Sir, Valsalam.
Excellent. Excellent. So this is nothing but a Valsalam. It's also called as a curved Ellis forceps. I'll not get into the nitty gritty of that. So coming back, it has ratchet, box joint, stainless steel, autoclave, common for everything. What is the advantage? Because it has multiple tooth, it will grab onto something really hard. It will cause a lot of trauma, but it will hold on really good. All right. So are you supposed to use this on delicate tissues like intestine? Yes or no?
No, sir.
That's all, simple. Because it causes a lot of trauma, we can't use it on soft tissues. So where else are you going to use it? Which are the hard tissues in the body?
Tendons,
fascia, aponeurosis.
Aponeurosis.
Simple. So these you already know. If it has a tooth and there is a gap here where it doesn't completely occlude, it is called as Ellis forceps. So it is used to hold fascia and aponeurosis. Avoid holding the skin because it is so traumatic, you'll end up having holes in the skin, which looks very bad post-operatively. That's the only reason. So what is this forceps? It doesn't have a tooth and it has a triangular fenestration.
Babcock's forceps.
Babcock's forceps. Okay. Complete answer. It's a? That you leave. Regularly, how are you going to say it?
It's
I'm pointing out something here.
It has a ratchet, has a box joint.
What is the instrument made up of?
A stainless steel, and it's sterilized by autoclaving.
Simple. Now you need to know the specialty of one extra thing. What is the advantage of this triangular fenestration? Basically, it means that it is used to hold a tubular structure. Okay, you can see here, even after closing, there is a small space between the two limbs. Okay, it has a flat blade. In Ellis, it is a toothed blade. Here, it's a flat blade. So it is supposed to hold a tubular structure. Now, the advantage of this triangular fenestration basically means that even when you're holding, if there is a small gap, you'll allow this tissue to bulge out. Okay, so you're not causing too much trauma. Now, if I'm holding it really tight, that means I'm squishing it and causing some vascular compromise, or I'm even damaging the tubular structure for all I know. If I'm trying to hold, like for example, the appendix, or I'm trying to hold the cord structures, I might really squeeze it if that gap is not there. Because the gap is there, this will bulge out like this. So it gives space for the tissues to bulge out. That is the only specialty of this. Otherwise, Ellis is used to hold the more tougher structure. Babcock is used to use the more softer tissues. like intestine or tubular structures such as your vas deferens, your cord structures, then your appendix.
Fallopian.
Pardon me?
Fallopian tube.
Correct. Excellent. So any tubular structure basically. So even though it doesn't have any teeth, it is still a traumatic forceps. Okay. I am not, few of them might, we'll probably ask if there are any seniors at the end of the class, whether this comes under traumatic or atraumatic, but as long as there is a ratchet, according to me, everything is a traumatic forceps. Okay. So this is something like Babcock's forceps. Again, this has a fenestration, but if you look carefully here, you can see this side, there is a tooth, and this side, there is a space for the tooth to go and sit. Okay. Does anyone know the answer? What's the name of this?
Lane's forceps.
Correct. It's called the Lane's tissue holding or Lane's gland holding forceps. Now, common sense. If I am trying to puncture something, do I want to take the tissue out or do I want to leave it back inside the body?
To take the tissue out.
Simple. So, again, here also, basically, it is used to take out your salivary glands or lymph nodes. No, you want to make sure they don't slip off. So you're going to put it and that tooth will go and dig into it. And this is, should be used only on structures which are coming out. Don't try to do this on some adrenal gland or something where you hold and you just want to see where the adrenal vein is. So you can't puncture the adrenal and leave it back. So it's only supposed to be used on glands or any tissue which is coming out of the body, not something you're planning to leave it inside. Okay, that is the importance of the tooth. Why is it? How do you remember Lane? If you look carefully, it looks like a lion. Okay, that's how I remember it, because it has a jaw and looks like a lion. So that's how I remember it as Lane's. Because Babcock's, we use day in and day out, so I know what a Babcock is. And the only one which looks like a Babcock is a Lane's gland holding forceps. So the importance is on structures which are coming out of the body, such as lymph nodes and salivary glands. And again, the gap is there to avoid the tissue to bulge out. For example, if I'm holding a lymph node, if I'm sending a lymph node for biopsy, it is always better I send the entire lymph node in toto. I shouldn't rupture and take it out in pieces. Okay. So it'll allow the lymph node to bulge inside the forceps. That's the only advantage. What is this?
Sponge holding forceps.
Correct. It's also called as Rampley's sponge holding forceps. Everything else is the same. It has transverse serrations. It has a hole. As the name suggests, sponge holding. It is used to hold your mops and your gauze pieces, and which you dip in betadine and you do painting over the body. You know, before surgery, they paint with betadine. We call that act as painting to sterilize that area. So that is where it's used. One more use is in gallbladder surgeries or cholecystectomies. We use this to hold and pull. So if it has transverse serrations, is it traumatic or atraumatic?
Traumatic.
Excellent. That's all. See, they're actually pretty simple. Once you understand what it is, 3/4 you'll answer on your own. And the next one or two, you need to just mug up a bit. And if you have seen surgeries, you'll remember it better. So what are these?
Towel clips.
Correct. So this is the Mayo's towel clip. And this is the Doyne's. Okay. So this looks like a small letter D, like how we write, no? Small letter D. So that's why I remember it as Doyne's. Okay. Obviously, the other one has to be Mayo's. So that's how I remember it. So if someone gives you the Mayo's, again, you have to tell the same thing. It has ring, it has ratchet, it has box joint, and it has two tooths. It's a traumatic forceps, and it is used to hold towels. After painting, we drape the patient, right? So once we drape, we need to make sure the drapes don't fall off the patient's body. So we use these clamps and to make sure one drape sticks to the other and you're holding everything in place and preventing it from falling down. Now in Doyne's, this is a spring loaded. Okay, there's no ratchet. It's like a spring. For example, I'll just show you this forceps. See, once I press and leave, So once I press and leave, it comes back to its natural position. So it is a spring action and the spring is loaded here. Spring doesn't have to mean like the one you see in your jetter pen at the end. It doesn't have to be a coil. Anything which has some inbuilt memory, which goes back to its natural position after you take off the force, is called as a spring. So here the spring action is loaded at the distal end. So once you press this, the towel clip opens. Once you release it, it closes back. Okay. Next question. Can you see there are some transverse serrations here? Why is this transverse serrations? Why does this have transverse serrations?
So probably to hold the instrument at that area.
Correct. Now, can you see this instrument? This is a regular tissue holding forceps, what you use while suturing. Can you see there are serrations here also? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So simple. It's for grip. If I, like I dropped the instrument that time, you all saw, no? Because I was holding it here where there was no grip. So this is a practical example. So if there is serrations, it will give you better grip to hold on to the instrument. That's all. So it's the same thing, stainless steel, box joint, autoclaving to hold sterile drapes in place and avoid holding skin, because obviously you're going to cause a hole in the skin, which doesn't look good. It will cause pain and all in the post-operative period. And in joints, instead of saying ratchet and joint, you have to say it has a spring action. And again, it is used to hold sterile drapes in place and you avoid holding skin. What is this instrument?
So bowel clamp, sir.
Correct. Why are you saying it's a bowel clamp?
Sir, because of the long blade and longitudinal serrations.
Excellent answer. See, that is all I wanted you to notice in this picture. If you understood this, more than enough. What I told you, if it is transverse serrations like this up to down, that is called as traumatic forceps. Anything which longitudinal serrations are invariably relatively atraumatic. Okay. I like this word called relatively atraumatic, but please follow what is being taught in your college. If they expect you to answer atraumatic, kindly answer atraumatic. Okay. Otherwise, rest of it is the same. It has a joint, sorry, it has a ratchet, box joint, and a jaw with longitudinal serrations. It is sterilized by autoclaving and it is used only to clamp the lumen of the intestine. If you clamp it too tight with a very traumatic forceps, you'll even be blocking off the blood supply as well. Whereas in here, the idea is to only clamp the lumen. You don't want any feces or anything to come in the way when you're suturing. That is why you're going to use bowel clamps. So now coming to retractors. Can I have two other volunteers or will the same two continue if others don't speak up?
Anybody interested can unmute and answer. Okay, there are so many.
Unmute and I'll use the same two people anybody. For the next section.
Aishwarya is there, Avantika is there, anybody. Okay, who are interested to answer can unmute themselves and answer directly. Okay, but be quick, that's all.
Yeah, no, two of you unmute and stay unmuted for this entire section. We don't want to waste time, that's why. Is anybody there? If yes, please say yes.
Yes, sir.
Your name?
Ashray.
Neem Budapa. Neem back up again.
Oh.
Okay, anyway, we'll start off with Tappan and Ashray. Probably you need to give them more motivation.
Yeah.
Now, what is this instrument? I've already given you the heading that it's a retractor.
Langenbeck.
Okay. So how do you remember it is Langenbeck? L shape.
L
for Langenbeck. At least remember this much. Okay. Now, two more questions I'll ask you. Why is there a hole here?
It decreases the weight, sir, of the instrument.
You're doing all my job, man. What should I teach you then? Okay. And what is this bend, the terminal bend you can see, no? Why can't it just be straight? Why is it bent like this?
Sir, to hold the lever up. Otherwise, it will slip down. That's why.
Excellent, man. Hey, Tapan, mute yourself, man. Somebody else come. He's spoiling all the jalwa of the class now. Okay. Now I'll give you a small analogy as to why there is a hole here. Okay. It's like bird's bones. How is bird's bones different from a human bone?
Pneumatic.
They're hollow. Okay. So the bone weight is very light when compared to a human bone. Same thing. Just imagine if this entire thing, why is it broad here? It's broad here because you need to have a good grip. All right. If it's something narrow like this, I'm trying to hold, I'll keep slipping off, or I need to put a lot of effort to hold it in place. So assume something is broad like this. So I have a good grip over it. Okay. So if it is broad and I fill this entire thing with very strong metal, it becomes so heavy. So my hand, there'll be a lot of fatigue, not only from retracting, but also lifting the weight of the retractor. So invariably retractors have a hole here to make the handle broad and to make the retractor lighter. Okay. And like Tapan said, the edge of the most of the retractors are curved. Most of it. That is because I'll give you a practical example. Something like this, I'm trying to pull. At a certain point, my hand will slip. Okay, if I'm trying to retract, this is the retractor. L shape, I'm trying to pull, it will slip. Now the same thing with a little curve. If I hold, I can lift this up quite comfortably. So the terminal edge will give you a little bit of hooking capacity to the retractor to make sure that you can retract it well. So basically, initially the Langenbachs was used for cholecystectomy. It is actually used for superficial and slightly deeper structures, but not commonly used to retract the deeper structures. So again, it is made up of stainless steel, autoclaving, the broad handle is for better grip, the hole is to reduce the weight, and what I told you, the terminal bend is to hook the tissues. So what is this retractor?
Zerny's retractor.
Correct. It's called the Zerny's retractor, which starts with the C. The C is silent. Why is there a gap between these two?
Sir, to see the area for suturing and all, sir. If I remember only that part.
That's all there is to it. So again, it is made up of stainless steel. It is sterilized by autoclaving. The hole is to make it lighter. Now, imagine this is the edge of the suture. If I'm using a Langenbach like this, I am blocking the edge of the wound. I can't see what I'm doing. The same thing if I'm using a Zerny's and I'm retracting, I can see the edge, all right? The structure in the center, I can still see it. That is the only advantage, is that you can visualize the edge of the tissue of what you're retracting so that you can see the suture better to make sure that you've taken the suture from the edge of the wound. So that's the only thing. So yeah, here, to improve visualization of the suture through the edge of the wound. What is this retractor?
Morris
retractor. Morris was actually a assistant of Langenbach. Okay, so he realized that if the liver is so broad and you're using a small retractor like this, the liver will flop around the retractor like this. Okay, it will tent around the small Langenbach, it will tent and it will come down. So what he designed, he made it slightly broader when compared. If this is Langenbach, this is Morris. Okay, he made it much more broad. And one important point, there's a curvature here. Can you see? Here there's a curvature. In Langenbach, this part will be straight. This part will be straight. Whereas in Morris, there'll be a small curve. Okay. Basically, the curve is to just give you a bit more mobility or more freedom when you're operating. If it is straight, your suture might keep hitting somewhere or your instrument might keep knocking there. The same thing if it's a bit curved. Okay. I'll show like this. If it's a bit curved, you will have more freedom, more place to move your instrument that side, this side. That's the only advantage. So it's broader when compared to Langenbach. It has a curved edge to allow for more freedom. Otherwise, it's made up of stainless steel, sterilized by autoclaving. Okay. And rest of it, you have to say the same thing. It has a broad handle and a hole in the center to reduce the weight of the retractor. This is the Devers retractor. All right. So what you need to remember is the difference between a Devers retractor and a Morris retractor is, in Morris retractor, the hook is near the patient's side. Okay, this part goes into the patient's body. This is what you are holding. Whereas in a Devers retractor, the hook is on the surgeon's side or the assistant side. So he'll get better grip. Okay, it's like how you hold Mahishasura nodi, machirkondirutha nodi. The same thing, turn it the other way around, you get a Devers. Exactly the same way. Instead of like this, you're hitting somebody, here you're retracting it back. Okay, if this is the curve, I'm lifting the retractor like this. So this curve is for giving you better grip. It will sit above your index finger when you're holding it. And this is used to retract deeper structures. Till now, whatever retractors we saw, they are used to retract slightly superficial and relatively deeper structures. But the really deeper structures, like the minute I go down into the near the aorta, where I need to push the intestines or where I need to retract the abdominal wall in order to see lower down, that time I'm going to use the Devers retractor because it's long and it has a curve which will help me retract and hook it up and even see better. Okay. So normally it is used to retract the deeper structures like liver in cholecystectomy and abdominal wall when we're doing laparotomy. And what is the importance of this? The terminal bend is on the handle, that is the surgeon's side and not on the patient's side. What is this retractor? Doyne's retractor. Excellent. It is used to retract the bladder in pelvic surgeries.
Pelvis, sir.
Okay, otherwise most of it is the same. Wide, broad handle, holes in between to hold it better. Now my next question. These two look extremely similar. Your, what is that? Doyne's retractor and your Morris retractor. How will you differentiate the two?
Serrations are there at the handle which we...
Excellent answer. I was hoping you'd say that. But that is the wrong answer. I'll just give you a small analogy. When the cricketer bats, you're looking at his bat or his handle grip?
Bat.
So the same way, this is the bat. Okay? The grip, anyone can put whatever color he wants, design it however he wants to make it look, however beautiful or however different they want to. All right? So this is the business end or the most important one. In Doyne's, can you see this line which attaches the hook to the actual retractor is straight?
Yes, sir.
Sorry, in a Morris retractor, it is straight.
Morris, yes, sir.
In a Doyne's, it is curved. That's the only difference. This also has a curve. This also has a curve. But this line is straight. The line which joins the terminal edge with the actual retractor. Whereas here, it is curved. All right? That is because Doyne's retractor is used to retract the bladder. And you let it hang down between the legs of the patient when you're doing a hysterectomy. So you need a lot of space to operate. You can't expect it to keep sticking out. So you need to hook it and it has to sit down like this so that you have a lot of freedom to operate. This is used in upper abdominal surgeries on the other side, that is near the liver and the gallbladder and all. So this will go above the chest wall. This, there is no problem. It doesn't have to fall to the ground. It will go over the chest wall when you're retracting the liver. This is what we call as a Balfour self-retaining retractor. This bit, okay, this is the Doyne's retractor. Now, where is this used in upper abdominal surgeries or lower abdominal surgeries?
It's used to retract abdominal wall tissues.
I know. I asked you upper or lower? Doyne's retractor loop yok tarappa.
Doyne's retractor lower.
Excellent. Aste. That's all you need to have. Little bit of common sense. Keep your eyes open. The clues will pop out at you. Most of you already know the answers. Okay. So there's a Balfour self-retaining retractor. What is the advantage of a self-retaining retractor?
It is more free.
Adjustable blade, sir.
That's okay. But what is the actual advantage?
One less person to hold the tissues
for you. That's all. So you will have one or two assistants less in number when you're using this, or their job will be less. Okay. Now this bit in between where the Doyne's come and sit, this is attachable. It can be removed. So it is with or without the Doyne's retractor. Just because Doyne's retractor is not there, don't call this something else. It is still the Balfour retractor only. This bit is called the Balfour with or without Doyne's retractor, predominantly used in pelvic surgeries. Okay. And like Tapan said, one less assistant. Tapan, I have a doubt. You have seen my PPT beforehand.
No, sir.
Okay. Now, till now, we have covered almost half the class. Now, I told you guys something. Autoclaving is done for all instruments except?
Sharp.
So, what are you going to sterilize sharp instruments with?
2% glutaldehyde.
Okay. But sterilization, that comes under disinfection. Sterilization is ETO, ethylene oxide.
Okay, sir.
Okay, simple. Till now, everything autoclave. Blindly say autoclave for any metallic instrument. Anything apart from which is not a scissor. If it is a scissor, you're supposed to say ETO. Because they say autoclaving can cause blunting of the scissors and the instruments. Now, first question. What is the difference between a tailor scissor and a surgeon scissor?
Screw joint and box.
Both of them are screw joint. They don't have a box joint. Both of them have a screw joint.
Sir, liver is what's the tip for the surgeon scissors.
Okay, I will just show both of you. I mean, to everyone. This is a regular scissor. This is a surgical scissor. All right. This joint is close to the handle. Can you see?
Yes, sir.
This joint is close to the handle or it's close to the tip?
Blades, yes sir, it's closer to the blades.
Closer to the jaws or the blades. So yes, basically, you're going to get more precise or fine cutting because you're trying to cut with the tip of the scissor. You're not trying to cut with this edge, not here. You're trying to cut with the tip of the scissor. So the farther away the joint is, the more precise it becomes. So surgical scissor is very precise. So the joint is,
sir, it's closer to the blades.
Correct. So in a surgical scissor, it's closer to the blades, so it gives you more control and more precision. Whereas a barber scissor or a tailor scissor is more towards the handle. Okay. So what are these scissors? Okay. What are the names of the scissors you know?
Straight scissors, curved.
Okay. Okay. There's something called Mayo and Metzenbaum. Two names you need to know. Mayo and Metzenbaum. Mayo is the fat scissor. Metzenbaum is the thin and fine long scissors. How do you remember it? If you keep on eating mayonnaise, what will happen? Simple. Got it?
Yes, sir.
So a Mayo scissor will be like something like this. It is very heavy, thick and strong scissors. Okay. Metzenbaum is a fine scissors for fine dissection. So this is a Metzenbaum scissor. I know it's very difficult to make out an image. That's why I gave you the answer. What is it made up of?
Stainless steel.
Steel. Does it have ratchets?
Sir?
Does it have a ratchet?
No, sir. No ratchet.
What joint?
Box joint or screw.
If you're seeing a screw, how is it a box joint?
Sir, a screw.
If you can see a screw, it's a screw joint. Simple.
Okay, sir.
Okay, don't go by the shape of this. I've told you, box joint is where it goes one into the other.
Yes, sir.
Here
yes,
it
sir.
Is just sitting on top of each other.
Oh, yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, so this is a screw joint. So no ratchet, stainless steel, screw joint. It's a scissor. It is autoclaved by
ETO.
ETO. That's all. So Mayo scissors are usually heavy scissors to cut dense tissue and suture materials. Avoid autoclaving because they'll become blunt if you use it. This is your Metzenbaum scissor, which is.
Sir, what is the spelling of it? Sir, what is the spelling of that Metzenbaum scissors?
Bartadini, Samadhana, here. You'll get the slides, don't worry. Okay? This is a Metzenbaum scissor. It's long and it's used for fine dissection when compared to a Mayo scissor. What is this? It's a suture cutting scissor. Okay? It has a curvature at the tip. This is exactly a suture cutting scissor. Why? Because if I have a suture like this,
heats.
Okay?
Heats. H-E-A-T-H-S. Heats.
Okay, I didn't know the name. Thank you. It's called a heats suture cutting scissor. So, okay, here. So, this curve will allow you to get beneath the suture without causing any damage and cutting it. Okay? Now, important. How do you hold this scissor? The tip should either point towards you, or when you're holding it down, it should point upwards. This curvature, no? It should point towards you when you're holding, or it should point upwards. So if I'm holding the scissor like this, where the curvature is pointing down, that means it is wrong. That is because when I'm cutting like this, I can end up cutting the patient's skin rather than the suture. All right. So it should always be held with the point either pointing upwards, or if you're holding it like this, it should point towards you. It shouldn't point towards the examiner, nor it should point down. Otherwise, rest of the points are the same. Now, any more, this one, anyone's ready? All the best, Ashray and Tapan. Okay. So what is this instrument?
Needle holder.
Needle holder, sir.
Correct. Can you see the serrations here?
Yes, sir.
What sort of serrations are these?
Crisscross.
Correct. Where else in the body do you see crisscrossing of fibers? Linea. Alba.
Alba, yes.
Okay, that is where you have crisscrossing. So basically what it means is, assume there are transverse serrations and I try to hold a needle in it. The needle, if the transverse serrations are like this, it will not move that side, this side, because the serrations are holding it. But it can still flip that side, this side, no?
Yes, sir.
In between the two serrations, if it is sitting, it can still, it can rotate like this slightly.
Yes, sir.
That is why you have crisscross serrations, to make sure even that little movement is not there, so that the needle sits really tightly. Next important point, there's a small groove here in the center of it. Can you see this area which is white? That is the needle. As we know, most of the needles we have are curved. If I try to hold it on a flat structure, I'll end up making the needle also flat if I'm trying to compress it like this.
Yes, sir.
That is why there is that groove. That groove will accommodate for the needle. Okay. If this is the groove in the needle holder, the needle will sit like this. and the other instrument on top, the other jaw will come and sit. The needle will hold like this. So you're not altering the curvature of the needle when you're using a needle holder. That is why you should not, this is the main difference between a needle holder and a straight artery forceps. Otherwise, most of it is the same. So look at the serrations before you answer. If it is just transverse serrations and it is straight, it's a straight artery forceps. If it is crisscross serrations and a gap or a groove in the middle, it's called as a needle holder. Okay. Otherwise, just the same ratchet, box joint, and crisscross serrations with a groove. It's a needle holder. It is used to hold needles and helping in suturing. Otherwise, same. A sterilization and all is autoclaving and it is stainless steel. This is an Addison's forceps. It can either be non-toothed or it can be toothed. If it is non-toothed, it is atraumatic. That means you're not picking onto something. If it is toothed, that means you're digging into something. So it goes back to your Allies versus Babcock's answer. Allies, you're going to hold what? Fascia and aponeurosis. Babcock, you're going to hold intestine. So the same thing. Non-tooth forceps, you're going to hold for intestine and soft tissues. Tooth forceps, you're going to hold for either skin, fascia, or aponeurosis. Okay. So this also has serrations. This will be the spring action. So when your forceps are here. So the spring action will be like this. Once you press, you leave, it will go back to its natural state. Okay. The same thing will be there even with this forceps. It's called an Addison's forceps. This is your tissue holding forceps. What I'm holding in my hand, this is exactly the same, except this is a tooth forceps. This is a non-tooth forceps. So the same thing. So please have a look at the edge before you answer. So you can call it as a tissue holding tooth forceps or non-tooth forceps. And the purpose is the same. If it's tooth, they're holding dense tissue like fascia, aponeurosis, or skin. If it is a non-tooth, you're using small blood vessels. You're trying to handle the IVC, aorta, etc. Or even if you're holding intestines, you're going to use the non-tooth forceps. Finally, organ specific. Like these are normally used specially for one particular organ. Have you seen this?
Yes, sir. Thyroids, jaws, self-retaining.
Jaws, thyroid, retractor.
Self-retaining retractor. Yes, sir.
Excellent answer. Jaws, self-retaining thyroid retractor. It is used to keep the subplatysmal flaps away. They might ask you, if not this, what else are you going to use? You can use sutures. You can just stitch up the skin and stitch it up to the towel and keep it apart if you don't have a retractor in your hospital at that point of time. And for every surgery, you need two retractors. This they might ask you. You need one on that side, one on this side. So you need two retractors for surgery. This forceps?
Moynihan's.
It's a Desjardins choledocholithotomy forceps. Why is it a choledocholithotomy? Everything common sense, okay? First, it doesn't have a ratchet, okay?
Yes, correct? Sir. Yes,
so
sir.
It falls under the category of atraumatic, at least initially.
Relatively
atraumatic. Next, can you see any serrations on this or is just one round, one hole? Any serrations can you see?
No, sir.
No. So if it has no serrations, that is atraumatic. Now, what happens if you crush a CBD stone? What will happen? The stone will sit off inside the CBD only, you know, when you're doing a CBD exploration.
Yes, sir.
The idea is to take out the entire stone without crushing it. Yes, or you shouldn't damage the mucosa when you're coming out. Mm-hmm. So that's the reason you're going to do this. Okay.
Yes.
So, and the curve of this instrument is so that you can get all the way down into the CBD, go up to the duodenum or the ampulla vater. And the same thing when you're going from this side, you can go all the way up to the hepatic duct if there is some stone on top to retrieve it. That is the advantage of this forceps. Okay. So it has no serrations, no ratchet. Most important to avoid crushing the stone and avoid injuring the mucosa in the CBD. Okay. So everything common sense. What is this? The name is already here, so I shouldn't ask this question. It's a Kelly's proctoscope. It is of two parts, the obturator and the proctoscope sheath. You introduce both together inside the anal canal once the patient is in SIMS position and you take out the obturator and slowly retract the sheath and see if any hemorrhoids or something prolapses into the lumen as you're examining it. Now, again, it is a stainless steel. So you can say autoclaving. Sometimes you can get away with disinfection. Okay, I'll just take about 2 minutes to tell you a very important concept. Do you guys know what is critical, semi-critical and non-critical instruments?
No, sir.
No. Okay. Anything which you are cutting the tissue and going inside into sterile area is called as critical. Like your artery forceps, your needle holder, anything where you're cutting the body and going inside into a lumen or into a cavity. That's called as critical instruments. Okay. Any surgical instrument for that matter, everything in, including the towel clip, because that can still come in contact with the tissues inside the body. Semi-critical is like your endoscopes or your proctoscopes, where you're going through a natural orifice into a particular lumen. And your non-critical are the instruments which just come in contact with the skin, your thermometer, your stethoscope, your BP apparatus, your sphygmomanometer. Okay. Critical means it has to be absolutely sterile and it's going inside a body cavity or it's coming in touch with the body tissue. Semi-critical means it is coming in contact with the mucosa of a natural orifice. Okay. So that is your mouth and your anal canal or your bronchoscope, your Ryle's tube, all these come under semi-critical instruments. And your non-critical are your stethoscope, BP apparatus, thermometers. So now coming to sterilization of these categories. If it is critical, it has to be sterilized by, it has to be sterilization. And sterilization means you're killing off everything, including spores. Your semi-critical, that is your endoscope and your proctoscope, they come under semi-critical. Here, even high-level disinfection also will is okay because you're already going into an infected area such as the oral cavity or the rectum. So high-level disinfection is also okay, where you don't kill off the spores, but you're killing off majority of the bacteria. And the last, that is your thermometer and your stethoscope and all, for that low-level disinfection. Okay, there are, I'll not go into it because it's out of the scope of this class, but I'm just giving you a rough idea. So for a proctoscope, it falls under the semi-critical instrument. So you can even say high-level disinfection and autoclaving. Okay. Now here the diagnostic is, like I said, you're doing a diagnostic examination. Therapeutic is if I want to do a hemorrhoid surgery, I need a proctoscope to look at the hemorrhoid pedicle. So it's a therapeutic procedure that time. Tubes. Okay, you guys only continue because I'm running out of time. So I'll finish off in the next 10 minutes. This is, I think, the last but one thing. Okay, what is this? What tube is this?
Ryle's tube.
Ryle's tube, excellent. It's a nasogastric Ryle's tube. What is the specialty? What can you see here? The tip.
So it is a lead containing. Correct.
So you have lead shots. Whatever is inside this green, you have lead shots. Why do you have lead shots?
So it gives weight to the tips so that it can discern.
Makes it radio opaque.
Yeah, radio opaque. Weight okay. For such sorry. Small lead shot doesn't make sense because okay. The tube itself is a bit brittle and it's not. It doesn't just flap on like a piece of gauze or something like that. So ideally it is radio opaque. So when you take an X-ray, if you see three lead shots somewhere, you know where the tube is or where the tip of the tube is. Okay. Can you see this green line on the tube? There is a green line here. Can you see?
Yes, sir.
What is the green line?
Sir, that is the radio opaque line.
So this part is also radio opaque and you have a green line which runs all along the tube. So you know the exact course of the tube. You don't need to know only the tip. You can see the entire tube inside when you take an X-ray. That is the advantage. Now, anything which is transparent in surgery, the material you can blindly say it is medical grade PVC, polyvinyl chloride, anything which is transparent, medical grade PVC. So how are you going to sterilize this? If you put a plastic into autoclave, that is high temperature and steam, what will happen to the plastic?
Melt.
So you can't autoclave any tubes. Simple. Okay. So what is the next sterilization technique? What are you going to do for scissors?
CT.
Same thing you answer here.
Yes.
Okay, so you have only two answers. Autoclave, ETO.
Yes, sir.
All metallic instruments autoclave except for scissors instruments. And everything else apart from that, blindly answer ETO. Okay. So this is a Ryle's tube. It usually measures 100 centimeters in length. It has three lead shots. It has a radio opaque line, which will help you see where exactly it's going. Sterilized using ETO technique. So diagnostic test. And diagnostic uses. One, the Bates test. We know in pancreatic pseudocyst, I'll not go into it. I want you guys to read up about it. You'll get the slide. Please look at it. Now, if someone comes to you with blood, okay, you don't know whether it is hemoptysis or hematemesis. Patient is not giving you history properly. Put in a Ryle's tube. If you get blood from the stomach, that means it is hemoptysis. If there is no blood from the stomach, that means it is
hematemesis.
If it's blood from the stomach, it's hematemesis. Otherwise, it is hemoptysis. So that is the diagnostic value of the Ryle's tube. Then to diagnose tracheoesophageal fistula, those different types, head shape, etc. Now, if it is therapeutic, it is used to decompress the stomach. If someone is having a lot of vomiting or pyloric obstruction, you want to decompress the stomach. That is one reason. Then it's used for feeding. You can give them near Ryle's tube feeds. And after stomach surgeries, this will act like a drain. Okay, after you're stitched up or you've done a stomach resection, you can put these tubes in place, and that will, if there is some blood or something oozing from that wound, that will be sucked out by the Ryle's tube, and you'll get an idea, oh, I have to be careful with this patient. Contraindication is CSF rhinorrhea. If any patient who comes with trauma with CSF rhinorrhea, don't try putting the Ryle's tube, will end up going through the hole and causing more damage. So that is a contraindication of a Ryle's tube. What is this?
One second. Why are those markings in that 100 centimeter? There are 30, 40, the markings are there.
Different.
Why are those markings are there, Tapan?
GE junction, body of stomach, duodenum level.
Like how much to go inside? How much to put inside? We should know, no? SS, no? It's by those.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Ideally, it goes depending. Ideally means patient to patient. You measure the Ryle's tube from here to the ear, ear to the Zippy sternum, and that is the length which should be at the tip of his nose. Okay? But otherwise, like Kishan said, you should have a rough idea. 40 centimeters is GE junction, 60 will be the pylorus. So it should be somewhere between 40 and 60, the Ryle's tube, the marking at your nose, in case you have not measured and you put it in a hurry. So what is this tube?
Infant feeding tube.
So what is the difference from a Ryle's tube?
No red shot.
No red shot, no marking. So it can't be used for a diagnostic purpose. Okay? Because you don't know where you're putting the tube in. If you're trying to put it and diagnose, it helps. Otherwise, there is no diagnostic purpose. So that is the main difference between the Ryle's tube and the infant feeding tube. So it has no lead shots, no radiopaque lines. It is used to decompress the stomach in infants and help feeding in infants who are in comatose and all, because you can't put a fat Ryle's tube into their nose. What is this tube?
Kerr's T-tube.
Correct. So does this also have those lines here?
No, sir.
Hey. There's a, yes. Okay, sorry. If not a green line, there's a blue line.
Oh, yeah.
Is it a blue line?
Yes, sir, sir, I saw.
Yeah. So any line like that is invariably a radio-opaque line. Okay. Mm-hmm. So this is normally used after you do a CBD exploration. You put this in, if the CBD is like this, you put this, this will go to the proximal end of the CBD near the confluence. This will go near the distal end of the CBD near the duodenum. And this comes out through the abdominal wall. Okay, so the bile will flow through this tube and come out. So it will give the rest to CBD. Once you're sutured, you don't want any structure to come in contact with the sutured CBD. So that is the advantage of it. So therapeutic is in CBD closure, and sometimes they even use it in feeding jejunostomies, but this should be only reserved if they keep asking you where else, that time you can say instead of a Ryle's tube, you can also use a Kerr's T-tube as a feeding jejunostomy. What are these tubes? Okay, the image is not very clear. It's an abdominal drain or a chest drain. Okay, have a look at this. Is there a line here?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, can you see this line is broken at one point? It's not continuous. Yes, there's a small gap here.
Yes, sir.
There is a hole there to drain fluid. What is the advantage of that line being broken there?
Sir, we can correctly pinpoint the depth at which the hole is present, whether correct. It is in the subcutaneous or...
Excellent answer. Yes, that is the answer. Okay. Especially when you're putting a tube for a pneumothorax or into the pleural cavity as a chest tube, you can have a look on the X-ray. The line will be straight. There'll be one gap and the line will continue. So the gap will indicate you where the hole is. So the hole should always be inside the pleural cavity. If it is outside, that is if it's inside the chest wall or if it is outside, the patient can either end up having emphysema or he can end up having pneumothorax from this side going in. Okay. So that is the advantage of the holes being along the line of the tube. So otherwise, rest of it is the same. Medical grade PVC. It has radiopaque lines, sterilized by ETO. Therapeutic uses. That is used to drain the peritoneal cavity if you're using it as an abdominal drain. And it is used to drain the pleural cavity if you're using it as a chest drain. What is this drain? Okay, it's a corrugated rubber drain. Okay, if it is transparent, what is it made up of?
Medical grade PVC.
Thank you so much. That's all. So basically here you're going to use it for drainage of surface wounds. I've done an IND and I have a feeling that the wound will close. I don't want the wound to close. So I'll put one corrugated rubber drain there, preventing the approximation of tissues. It's like if somebody's trying to close the door and you put your foot there, the door will not close. So the same thing is what the corrugated rubber drain is going to do. It is going to keep the wound open in order to let the pus and all drain out. What is this?
Foley's catheter.
It's a two-way self-retaining, because there is a bulb, Foley's catheter. What is the material it is made up of? I told you if it is transparent, you're supposed to say PVC. If it is anything other than transparent and other than it being red, you're going to say silicone or latex.
Okay? Yes, sir.
If it is red, say red rubber or Indian rubber. If it is anything, if it is transparent, you're going to say PVC. If it is red, you're going to say red rubber. If it is anything apart from that, say silicone, say latex. Got it?
Yes.
So this is made up of, you can have silicone, you can have silicone coated latex, and you have certain transparent catheters also, which are made up of medical grade PVC. But it depends on what catheter you have. One more clue. When they give this to you in the exam, they'll give it to you wrapped along with the wrapper also. Little common sense. At that point of time, just take the wrapper, flip it over, you'll see what the material is there then and there. Take about 5 to 10 seconds. Be calm, composed. Even if the examiner tells, tell fast, you still know what to answer. But you'll be more precise if you look at the answer, because he's giving you the answer to you. Okay, so take your time, answer. So like I said, it is self-retaining. It can be two-way or three-way. Where do we use the three-way Foley's catheter? Anybody knows? After prostate surgeries, okay? Because we need a continuous bladder wash. So from one way, water will keep coming. And from the other way, the water will keep flowing out along with the blood. And the center one is to distend your balloon, okay? So what is important is supposed to use distilled water and not normal saline. What will happen if you use normal saline in this bulb?
It will crystallize.
It will crystallize and this channel will get blocked off. So when you're trying to remove the catheter, you can't remove it. Okay, there will become a big mess. How to
can
remove
we use
it?
And air? Usually we inflate the balloons with air, no? Can we use air here?
You can, no, sir. But not, tell why.
It will float.
It will float.
Excellent. It will float. It will not drain. The tip will settle above the urine level, so it will not drain again. Very good.
Excellent. So what is this catheter?
Malakoff's catheter.
Yeah. What is the advantage of having a flower there? It looks like a flower, no? The tip. Self-retaining. So if this is neither red nor it is transparent, what is it made up of?
Silicone or latex.
Excellent. So if it is, you have red color Malakoff's catheter also. If that is there, then you have to say red rubber Malakoff's catheter. Otherwise, these two are the common answers. ETO, and it is self-retaining. This word is important. That is the whole point of having a Malakoff's catheter, because it is self-retaining. Now, what is this?
Red rubber catheter.
Excellent. It can also double up as a flatus tube. So it's a red rubber catheter or a flatus tube made up of red rubber or Indian rubber. ETO, disadvantage, it is not self-retaining. If you put it in, it will fall back outside. Okay. Usually used to decompress the rectum in cases of sigmoid volvulus. Earlier they used to do that because it will help the gases and all come out, and they thought that the sigmoid will derotate. But the problem with this is there is a high chance of recurrence, so which is not advised nowadays. Coming to miscellaneous, what is this? This is called the BP handle, the Bard Parker handle. There are two sizes. One is 3, one is 4. I have both of them in my hand. So you can actually compare. All right, the one on the right hand, the smaller one, is the three handle. You can see it's actually smaller, and the one on top is the number four handle. Why is this three and four? Just have a look at these blades. The smaller ones or the ones on the first row go to the number three handle. The bottom ones go to the number four handle. So just have a look at the numbers. If it is 11, can you see it is very sharp? So 11 number blade, this is only for surgical postgraduates. 11 number blade is used for a stab incision. Now this 12 number, can you tell me what instrument it mimics? What it looks like?
Cutting scissor.
It looks exactly like this, the shape?
It's a suture.
Exactly. So it is used to cut sutures. If you don't have a good suture cutting scissor, you can use a 12 number blade. The 15 number blade is neither curved nor it is sharp. It's a blend of the two. So it gives you very fine precision. It's like almost like a small paint brush when you're using. So it gives you very fine precision. All these bigger blades, they will actually help you put a very fat or thick incision which needs to go deep. And next point, where along the blade do you cut? It's neither the tip nor the end. It's called the belly of the blade. Okay, this part, the one in between, this is what you're supposed to use to make an incision. It shouldn't be like cutting a cake. It should be using the belly. You should make a slice like this and come out. So the same thing, stainless steel, sterilized using autoclave, and to make sharp incisions. These are the blades which we already discussed. This is a varies needle. It has a blunt trocar, blunt cannula and a sharp trocar on the outside, which has a spring action. How it works, what all it does, it basically used to insufflate the abdomen with carbon dioxide or to create pneumoperitoneum. That I'll do it on a separate day with the laparoscopic instruments, how exactly it is used, what are the principles and all. I'm just giving you the name. This is your Maryland grasper or your Maryland forceps. This is the laparoscopic variant of your curved artery forceps. Nothing great about it. Okay. This is your tooth grasper. This is almost the laparoscopic variant of your Cocker's forceps. Something similar. Then you have other laparoscopic instruments like harmonic. This, instead of using electrical energy, it uses ultrasound. Sorry, instead of diathermy, that is heat, it uses ultrasound. All right. So with that, I'll conclude my class. And if you guys have any doubts, fire it away.
Dear members, soon we shall have another session by Dr. Nishant on sutures and basic suturing technique, and also laparoscopic instruments on another separate session. Any particular doubts about these instruments, you can ask. I have a small suggestion for my friends here. In the examination viva, while answering for instruments, prepare in the following headings. First is always name of the instrument. Be it in try to tell the full name. For example, just now we saw one instrument that is a Foley's catheter. One answered Foley's catheter, another told the full names. That makes a lot of difference. Foley's two-way self-retaining rubber catheter. That's the full name of it. If you tell that way, then there is no question left for the examiner to ask you. Otherwise, he should be asking more and more questions. Is it two-way or three-way? Is it made up of rubber or silicone? So you will make him irritated more and more. Instead, in one line itself, tell the complete name of it. That's the way of answering in the examination. Tell the complete name and then be prepared to tell two unique identifying features of that particular instrument. Then just now, like we discussed, two uses and the sterilization technique. These four points we need to be prepared for Viva in the examination. Wonderfully presented, Nishant. Wonderful. Learned a lot today, really. And keep this in mind, tell the full name of the instrument in one go. And the second thing is he cleared all the doubts, how to remember and all, how to tell the sterilization technique, how to remember the sterilization techniques. So remember that way. So any other doubts from the members? Nishant, request you to teach our members the basics, all are interested before going to the internship. Please teach them the basics of the suturing techniques as well, like a simple suturing mattress and basics. And yeah, being that table tennis player, someone asking you why red rubber is red, red rubber, black rubber, you.
It's the dye which is used. Player,
you should be knowing that.
Yeah, I honestly don't know what the dye which was used to make the red, like the color red. I don't know what the name of the dye is, but it's called Indian rubber, the quality what we use. So the other colloquial term, because it looked red, everyone started calling it red rubber, but the actual name is Indian rubber. But why it's red, I don't know. There's probably some, it's like your Vicryl and all suture what you use. It's called Vicryl because it is violet in color. So it's that universal color coding what they use. Proline is blue, Vicryl is violet. Nylon is always black. So something like that. So they probably used red as a common terminology for that.
And all these PPTs of our sessions will be attached along with the YouTube videos. Okay, the links for these PPTs for the revision, it will be, you can find them in the description section of the videos of all our classes. Please make the best use of them and get the maximum benefit out of them. So thank you so much, Nishant. We'll be having cases, I think. And yes, all the volunteers also who participated in this discussion.
Thank you,
Ashna,
sir.
Are you there?
Yes, sir. It was a wonderful session. Thank you so much, Dr. Nishant sir, for providing insight to the instruments used in general surgery. We could learn a lot because of this session. Thank you so much, sir. We also thank Tapan sir and Sai Ashray sir for their active participation and enthusiastic answering. Thank you all the active participants. Thank you one and all.
Yeah. Thank you guys. Bye-bye. Have a nice day.
Thank you, sir.
Priya, let's end the session. Priya, are you there?